Well, hey, you guys, I want to give you a word of encouragement right now because, you know what, first of all, we can all go for a word of encouragement. And the number one thing I want to just share with you guys right now is the fact that it is rejoice time, church. It is time to rejoice and be excited for this reason. As we look around the world right now, there are events taking place. There are stages on the global scene that are in play that should cause us to be excited and rejoicing. Why, you might ask? Because of this one reason alone. The things that are happening right now are laid out in the Bible. Now, I'm not going to go into the details of that right now, but you should know this, that Russia, Israel, the United States, regarding what's going on with our culture, Russia, China, global events should not scare you, but should prepare you. These are things that God's word from Genesis to Revelation have foretold. So this is an amazing time. I would like to put it to you this way, and I think it's a good thing to keep in mind. Don't get caught up in trying to be sensational about things, trying to make every little thing be a prophecy thing. How about this? Rather than be sensational, take everything you see and match it against the Bible regarding stage setting. So, we don't want to be skeptics. That would push everything off the world scene and we would miss what God's doing. But we don't want to be sensational. That would cause everything, unnecessary things to be hyped up. So what do we do as believers at an amazing time like this? This is what we do. We look at the Bible with newspaper, online information, and what do? We set the stage. We see that God is setting the global stage with global events. And that should not surprise us because that's exactly what the Bible teaches. Again, from Genesis to Revelation, it's laid out that we might be able to discern and know the times and the seasons in which we live. The Apostle Paul told the church at Thessalonica that when certain things were coming together, that we should rejoice. Why? Because God was preparing the times and the seasons. And I believe from the Bible, not by opinion, not by what I teach because I'm teaching it or anybody else, but because the Bible says these global events are now in play, that I ought to at least be rejoicing. So you might say, Jack, how do we know? I mean, how can we really know for sure? This is what's awesome about the Bible. First of all, starting in Genesis to Malachi, God has given us the word announcing what he is going to do. It's called prophecy. So how do we know if the Bible is true? A lot of people say it's not. How can the Bible be approached in a way that's actually scientific? So imagine for a moment, I don't believe in the Bible. In fact, what I'm about to argue with you right now is the fact that God's word is so true that this is how I came to know the Lord, is by God's prophetic word, because 27% of the Bible is of the prophetic nature. Even the doctrine of salvation found in Genesis 3:15, God is announcing through what's called eschatology, announcement in advance, a prophetic statement that salvation would come through the woman. Eve would eventually bring forth a descendant of hers who would bring forth the Messiah of the world, Jesus Christ. That's prophecy. So from the Old Testament, how can we put it to the test to find out if the New Testament's true? Exactly that. You've got to know the Old Testament to see if the New Testament is true. The New Testament makes awesome and glorious claims. But have you ever noticed why in Matthew's gospel it says over and over again, and this is what the prophet said. And again, this is what was spoken of by the prophets. How do you know if the New Testament's true? The Old Testament makes the proclamation and the New Testament records its fulfillment. You can't have one without the other. One is the promise and the other is the prophetic fulfillment. It should bring to us great comfort. So first of all scripture is given by inspiration of God. That's what the Bible says about itself. And that is spoken, by the way, during the first century period. And it's announcing to us that all scripture, that would not only mean all of the Old Testament, but it would mean God's revelation of the New Testament. That's how we know that the new is qualified by the old. We match the new fulfillment against the old promise. The next thing is to keep in mind is that's exactly what Jesus used. That's exactly what he applied when he was witnessing about salvation, about himself, and about actually the fulfillment of the word. Jesus said on the Emmaus Road on that Sunday, that Resurrection Sunday, it's now evening, it's late, and Jesus comes suddenly up to two disciples that are heading home. And they didn't know who he was. And he said, "Why are you so sad? Why are you so bummed out?" And they said, "Are you a stranger in these parts? Don't you know the things that have transpired?" And they went on to inform Jesus about Jesus. They said, "Oh, it's so sad. We thought that he was the Messiah. We had hoped that he was the Messiah." What was Jesus's answer? Jesus began to answer to them about himself, and it says that he opened up the scriptures to them from Moses and in through the prophets, he revealed himself to them. What an awesome thing. Why is that important? Because the Bible again says both in the book of Psalms, Old Testament, and the New Testament, the book of Hebrews, that behold, in the volume of the book, it is written of me. That means every chapter of the Bible from Genesis to Revelation is about Jesus. That means it's incumbent upon you and I as Bible students to find Christ in the Word. As we meditate, as we wait upon the Lord, and look, as we look back at some of the great saints, when I think of what I'm saying right now, I'm immediately reminded of Charles Spurgeon. That guy could bring Jesus up out of the most obscure portion of scriptures and just cause your heart to be warmed by faithful doctrinal teaching and pulling Christ out of the Word. Jesus pulled himself out of the Word into the hearts of those doubting, fearful, confused believers on that Sunday evening of his great resurrection. Hey, I got to share with you something. I'm holding one of my Bibles. As a mechanic, you know, mechanics have a lot of tools, right, in their toolbox. Well, this is one of my Bibles, but almost all of my Bibles have this on the front, Titus 2:13. Why? This verse means everything to me because it says this in the Bible. Listen carefully. Titus 2:13 says, "Looking for the blessed hope and the glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ." Number one, this verse is undeniable regarding the deity of Jesus Christ. He is the great God and the Savior, no doubt about it. You can argue with that verse all you want, you're going to lose. Jesus Christ is God incarnate in flesh. But what I want to encourage you about in these days is this great, wonderful promise, looking for the blessed hope. The blessed hope is Christ's imminent return. Jesus could come at any moment, the Bible says. The great apostle Paul, in his letter to the Thessalonians, said, "We who believe, we who are looking, we who are waiting, will be caught up." He was referring to the rapture, to meet the Lord in the air. In fact, it's not until 2 Timothy 4 that Paul surrenders that blessed hope when he says that the Lord will give me a crown of righteousness, and not only me alone, but all those who have loved his appearing. It's the only time the Apostle Paul refers to the imminent coming of Christ now in the past tense. Why? Because God had revealed to Paul that he was going to die and not see the rapture. Every generation of Christians anticipates the imminent return of Christ. You, my dear friend Christian, you should be expecting Christ today and living as though you're going to meet him today, while at the same time occupying till the Lord comes, says the Bible. What does that mean? That means getting involved, using every bit of opportunity that God gives you today to advance the cause of Christ. Sign up for a mission trip. Plan to go to a prayer meeting. Get involved because, listen, Christ could come back today. That action causes you to be ready now. That action positions you really good for the future. That action now causes you to finish your race successfully for Christ. And another great portion of scripture is in 1 John 3:3, when John said that everyone who has this hope of Christ coming at any moment will purify himself. Listen, young people, old people alike, God's word, his entire word, all 66 books are inspired by the Lord to do what? To build us up and to equip us for righteousness and godly living. What is our mission? What should we do? Shouldn't even be a question. We should be answering this. How am I to live a righteous, effective, and light-bearing, salty life, I'll call it, in the culture in which I live in? That's the most exciting thing. Listen, life is not over for you. Yeah, the Lord can come back today, but we live it with the zeal of fulfilling His plan today, but positioning ourselves for what God wants to do in the future. That's how we are to approach our daily Christian living. So here's the challenge. Go to church. I know a lot of people are saying, I can't find a good church. We hear that all the time. We get emails, we get letters, we get people who come and visit on vacation. I can't find a church in my town. Well, listen, first of all, go to a Bible teaching church that teaches the entire Word of God, chapter by chapter, verse by verse, book by book, Genesis to Revelation. Go to a church that teaches the Bible. And by the way, the Holy Spirit will be present. You'll feel Him there. There'll be an excitement. There'll be a zeal. There'll be an anticipation. Even though Christ could come back today, there's a sense of excitement that God is moving in this church. You go to that kind of a church. You go to the church where God's Word is exalted and the people are excited. And listen, you can't hold people back. Because when those things are happening, man, the missions ministry is reaching the world. There's broadcast ministry through either radio, TV, internet, by whatever means. There's a passion to reach the lost. There's a great passion to build up the saints in the Word of God. It's a church alive. And there's some things you need to remember when you look for a godly church. It has to be, it must be, as Jesus said, "My Father's house shall be called a house of prayer." It must be a house of prayer, where there's prayer offered up, opportunity to pray. The next thing is that there's heartfelt, not robotic, but heartfelt, Spirit-led, in doctrinal truth, worship. It's to be a worshiping church. The third thing is that, as I mentioned earlier, the Bible. The Bible's to be cracked open from cover to cover, studying the Bible. You should go to a Bible study. You should go to Sunday mornings or midweek services or small groups or whatever it might be, and challenge with the Bible, that no matter what book of the Bible your pastor or your group leader is in, it's Bible-confirming Bible, just as Jesus taught us. The next thing is that, and this to me is the most exciting, pray, worship, the Word, but hey, you know what? What is that gonna do? It equips you for the final push. What is that? Service. Service. Wherever the Word and worship and prayer is happening in the life of a Christian, that church is going to be known for affecting the culture. That church is going to be alive. It is going to be reaching out. It is going to be, I'll tell you what, this is what it means. Jesus said to the church, "Let your light so shine before men." That word implies, by the way, unbelieving men, the men of the world, people of the world. "Let your light so shine before men that when they see your good works, they will glorify your Father which is in heaven." That's a reference to the day of judgment. That in the day of judgment, they're going to, as it were, tip their hat to you and your faithful service. Why? Because there was no place where you did not shine the effect of the gospel. Preach the gospel, that Christ died on the cross, rose again from the grave, that we're saved by Him, by faith in Him alone, on His merits, not on our own. That the gospel is open to all who will repent and believe. But the great thing is this, now that you're a believer, you're going to a Bible teaching church that honors the Word of God from Genesis to Revelation, you will be so equipped and you'll be busy about your Father's business. And what is it going to mean to you? Safe harbor. See, what do you mean? It means you're going to get caught, as it were, being busy about your Father's business when you either drop dead or you hear the trumpet blast to head up. That's what's going to happen. If you stay faithful to the ministry that God has called you to do, and by the way, if you're a Christian, God has called you to be faithful in a ministry, find out what it is, carry it out all the way through to the end. Be faithful at it. Why? Because you will be suited up, you will be armed against apostasy. People today who say, "Jesus can't come back today," they're introducing a spirit of apostasy. When they say, "Well, you know what? There's no imminency. I think it's going to be a while." The Bible says, watch out for people who say, "My Lord delays His return." Their life will get sloppy. They'll say sloppy things. They'll get away from the urgency and the excitement of Christ's near return. Friends, watch out. Be equipped against the day and the ages in which we live, which the Bible warns us is a time of apostasy. The scripture tells us, the Apostle Paul said, there's a time that's upon us. I'll change the word a little bit. He said there's going to come a time in the last days when men will not endure sound doctrine. I would say we're in those days. I will say it this way. The time is now upon us when men are not enduring sound doctrine and they're giving up. Don't you give up. Watch out for apostasy. We're in those days. And so I want to encourage you. This is an amazing time. Don't turn on the news and get bummed. If you hear somebody talking about Bible prophecy, get excited. The Bible says in Revelation chapter 19 that Jesus Christ himself is the spirit of prophecy. Jesus said, I've told you these things in advance that when they happen, you will know that I am he. What an awesome time to be alive. It's my desire that you share this video to everybody you know, because these are great days. Don't lose heart. God bless you guys, and we'll either see you here at church or we'll see you in the air as the Lord comes. Praise God. See you later.